one of the best welds I've made in weeks, man. Months. Apparently it's hurting his eyes. I just laid down a beauty, a veritable sparkle show. Ah, it smells like porosity. While back we did a video TIG 101, and it was geared toward putting everything together and getting started in the TIG welding world. We had a lot of great comments, and some of those comments centered around, well, how do I set my gas? What is the proper gas flow for TIG welding? So before we get back to this beautiful guy here, we need to go back on the machine and set our gas and talk about a few things. The very first thing that I need to do is to slowly open this and open it all the way. High pressure cylinders open all the way. Our flow meter is calibrated for argon and helium cubic feet per hour. In order for me to set the gas with this particular machine, I need to depress the foot pedal to energize the gas solenoid. I can go from 5 to 50 cubic feet per hour, which is excessive. That's way high. Since we're in an enclosed shop, no wind, no breeze, and I'm using standard size components, collet body, number 7 cup, 15 to 20 cubic feet per hour is plenty. We'll get into using gas lenses, and some of this cubic feet per hour will change slightly when we're using other components. The next thing we need to look at is what's available on the machine to set as far as gas. And on this particular model machine, I have everything amperage, everything pulse, AC and AC balance. I only have post flow on this particular machine. Okay. Some machines have a pre-flow function, which means when you depress the foot pedal, you can set a timer where you'll get a few seconds, even a half of a second, or a full second of pre-flow of gas. This is beneficial on stainless and some aluminum welding. It's not real critical on steels, okay? So I can do that manually by just depressing the foot pedal and have a little bit of gas coverage in my area, my weld area. I can pre-flood that. But getting back to this machine, it only has a post-flow setting. With a 3/32 size tungsten that I'm using, I'm welding at 135 amps, about 5 to 6 seconds is plenty. It allows my argon to flow out of the cup around the tungsten to protect it as it's cooling down. So I'm gonna set that at about 5 seconds. If I don't have enough post flow, let's say that I'm welding at 135 amps and I set my post flow at like 2 seconds or 1 second, which is obviously low, then I should notice my tungsten would turn dark gray, or even it'd be a dark color. Your tungsten should be the original color after you get through welding and it cools off. It should stay the original color of the tungsten. If it turns black, dark gray, some weird color, then you might want to turn your post flow up a few more seconds. Again, I'm setting this at 5. So this should cover the comment, you know, how to set my gas, how to set my machine properly. And I'll show you what this looks like. Hopefully I can make some good welds. But then after we get through with that, we're gonna mess some things up. We'll go through some scenarios and show you what happens if we make some adjustments and they're not right. Hopefully we can show you exactly how to troubleshoot this stuff and correct it. As you can see, we are not getting all that porosity in the sparkle show. Everything is smooth, stable, clean. Everything is just fine. It's fine. Okay, let's talk about post flow for just a second. As I terminated this weld, you'll notice that I stayed over my weld area. That's kind of a habit that I get into. A long time ago, just to help if I'm welding on stainless steel, I always like to leave that post flow over the top of this weld area. I do it on carbon steel too. Again, everything is real clean. My tungsten has good color to it. I maintain the Schleifwinkel on here, the good grind angle. So one of the things that we can change here is post flow. So the first thing we can talk about is, what if I have too much post flow? What if I have 15 to 20 seconds of post flow? Is that doing anything? No, you're just wasting gas, really. This machine goes to 10 seconds. I could have 10 seconds of post flow. It's not gonna really do anything. It's not gonna change the color. It's not gonna protect the tungsten anymore as it's cooling off. But if I have it too low, let's see what that looks like. I want to adjust this down to, we'll go a little above 1 second. We'll go in between 1 and 3 seconds. I'll make the same weld. The weld should look essentially the same, but when I terminate the weld, we should notice something with the tungsten here. It should turn dark. Let's see what happens. As you can see, everything is set essentially the same. Nothing's going to happen here. This was an adjustment in post flow. So gas coverage is essentially the same over the weld. It's only when I terminate the weld. And the tip of our tungsten got black. Is it fouled to the point of not using it? Not necessarily. Not on a non-critical weld, we can light right back up, reset the post flow, keep going. Critical application, I would change this tungsten out. So there's two examples of nothing. The only adjustment we made was the post flow. One normal at 5 to 6 seconds and one at 1 second or 1.5 seconds. The welds look essentially the same. The only thing that happened was it turned the tungsten black. On steels, it's not that big of a deal, okay? On stainless steel, nickel-based alloys and some exotic metals, it's nice to have some post flow and leave your torch down around there to help blanket the material as it's cooling off. Okay, now we'll do a couple of samples here where let's just turn the gas all the way up. You know, I never have. I have never turned the gas all the way up to the top of a post flow. So this is gonna be, it'll be a little fun for me. I'm gonna crank it up to 55, whatever it'll go to. Again, we're running standard components and a number 7 cup, so let's experiment. Pedal to the metal, crank her all the way up. Woo, she riding up on top there. 50 cubic feet an hour plus. Anybody heard of a Venturi effect of gas?
Well, I can sure hear the gas running out of there hard. I notice my weld is smaller.
Venturi effect is where it would be rushing out of the cup so fast that it draws in air behind the weld. The pool looked a little funny to me as I was welding it, but it looks fine visually afterwards. I thought I noticed a little spit thing in there. One thing I do notice is the edges of my weld are nice and black for some reason. You know, really all I'm doing is wasting gas. It's coming out of there so fast. It's not, all this excess gas is not doing anything. So essentially I'm wasting gas. All right, so the next thing we could do is turn our gas from our normal 15-20 and turn it way down so we don't have enough gas. Let's see what that does.
And this weld, we have too low of gas coverage. It acts like it wants to weld, but it's getting a little bubble riser in there as I see it. I know there's porosity coming out on the backside.
Lovely. I have labored to produce a weld with a bunch of L's in it, L's. Oh, there's that old brown manky stuff that I tried to get in one of my videos when I said it leaves this orange brown crap on your weld plate. Didn't get enough gas coverage. That's a beauty. Got a nice little riser on the end there. I'd call that something, but I don't want to offend anybody. camera guy is kind of verbally sensitive these days. So, you know, here's the deal. We went through the post-flow settings. We don't notice hardly any change whatsoever. We turned the gas all the way up, which is essentially wasting gas, just like having too many seconds of post-flow. It's just wasting argon. And then the obvious thing here of we created this beautiful visual aid here of not enough gas, period. You're just going to get porosity. Once it starts, you really can't correct it. Is this repairable? Sure. Grind it out, grind it down to good clean base metal, turn your gas back to where it's supposed to be, and weld it properly, and you'll be fine. So this porosity problem here was caused by not enough gas coverage. I had it set way too low. Let's get back to that beauty I laid down for you at the beginning of this video. With everything set properly, I still got porosity pretty bad, which leads us back to the viewer question. Question revolved around, what do I do with my tungsten? How far do I stick the tungsten out? Do I have it real close to the cup? That particular weld, I had it way out there. I just didn't. I wasn't, even though I have my gas set correctly, my tungsten is so far out there that my gas argon envelope was not around this weld pool. Didn't have a chance. Okay, so let's reproduce that scenario. I've got a number 7 cup on here, and I'm out like 1, 2, 3 times as far as what I should be. I'm out here a good 1.5 inches, and that's, you know, my gas coverage is not gonna be around this weld pool. So here's how I produce the beauty for you. See if we can do another one. There's some more of that brown orangey crap on there. You know what that reminded me of was a gasless flux core wire that was set incorrectly. It's just loaded with porosity. Too much tungsten stick out. Got no chance, no coverage. Well, some of you may be thinking to yourself, saying, self, how do I correct that? Let's go turn the gas all the way up again. Let's go crank it all the way up, plus have our tungsten stuck out here so we can see.
Yummy. This is a yummy specimen.
Oh, I definitely have gas flow because I can hear it. About the only thing that I noticed that doing is it threw my sparkles and my good stuff. It was high velocity because of the gas flow behind it. It still left a mess. Sticking your tungsten out too far is not gonna help you do anything as far as a quality weld pool. Out here in the flat plate, out in the open, gas coverage is just goes away. So I'm gonna get a fresh bullet here. There's one more thing we can do here, and that's run the tungsten way up in the cup or flush with it. I set the gas back to normal, back to about 15 cubic feet per hour where we made our beautiful welds with. So what do you think is gonna happen here? I like to set mine, whatever the exit diameter of the cup is, that's about where I like to start. And on this one, I have set it pretty much flush with the end of the cup. I've stuck it out there just a little bit so I can see it. I don't think anything is gonna happen as far as the weld pool. I don't think we're gonna create a really bad weld pool. What's gonna happen is I'm not gonna be able to see the end of the tungsten to judge where I'm at. It pretty much forces me to weld with a long arc. Well, I can't drag the cup physically on the plate. I can't get my filler wire down here where I can get underneath it. So what's gonna happen is I'll have plenty of gas coverage because it's right there at the end of the cup, but I've got my tungsten recessed up in here about a 1/16. I can't see the end of it. It's gonna be hard for me to judge this. Again, this is not something I'm normally do, so this will be like a first time for me. But these are all based on viewer questions, viewer comments, and helping people out. They're saying, well, this is what I'm doing and it's not working out, or something's not working out, and we find out what it is. And so Here we go. Let's see what happens. I had to put the cup clearly right down on the material in order to make the high frequency start the arc. I could not see the end of my tungsten. I was guessing the whole time. Actually, to me, visually, it looked like the arc was coming out off center in the nozzle here in the cup. Did it make a good weld? Yeah. I mean, there's nothing wrong with the weld as far as porosity. The width is okay. Got that weird black haze on the side of the start of it, but you know, again, there's so many options here. Got that window and that rule of thumb. Anyway, we went through gas setup, proper flow, post flow, and we showed some welds where we changed the post flow to nothing and we got a little dark color on the end of the tungsten. Didn't affect the weld. Post flow has nothing to do with the gas flow while you're welding. It's just when you terminate, if you don't have enough time set, this thing cools off and it oxidizes and turns black. Hopefully we showed that well enough. And then we had a little fun there at the end and cranked that tungsten out there about an inch and a half or so. We got no gas coverage because it was way out there too far. We even turned the gas up trying to correct it. It's not gonna happen. Okay, this good envelope of shielding gas is right around this end of the tungsten here. Again, the rule of thumb is whatever the opening is, that's about how far you stick your tungsten out. I keep saying about, you know. We can stick this out a little bit further than it is. We can go out a little past half, 5/8 of an inch, and we'll be fine. Okay. And the last thing we did was shove the tungsten up inside the cup. That was a little learning experience for me. I had a hard time getting the arc lit because it's up inside there. It forces you to long arc. You don't know where you're at. It's hard to get the filler wire on the leading edge of the pool as well. So I hope that answered the viewers' questions and concerns about proper gas flow. I'm trying to link a couple of issues here together and create some scenarios of what happens if you violate the envelopes, the window of opportunity for success here. So I sure hope this helps. I learned a little bit. I hope you did too. Appreciate your subscription to Weld.com. Hit the dinger button on there, the bell, so you can get notified when we put content out. Please check us out on Facebook and Instagram. Thank you. Lady standing behind me, she ran into the back of me with her bag, and she goes, "Uh-oh, I'm really sorry." I said, "That's all right. I just thought Dabs Wellington was on this plane." There's so much gas blowing out of here, I can hear it echoing through my brain cavity. Now that's some serious gas flow. Nice!